Thank you very much.
Thank you. Let's find another way. Honorable Swartbooi, it's your floor.
Thank you, Honorable Speaker, Honorable Peter Chetavikashagudi, for the floor.
Hishitevi. Yes. You see, there are few people who know me so well. No, no. There are few people who know even the very name that was given to me the day I arrived in this world.
Yes.
So that shows you that he does know something about me.
Indeed.
You continue.
Thank you very much, Honorable Speaker. Honorable Speaker, I want to thank Honorable McHenry Venani, whom I'm happy has survived COVID, thank God,
yes.
And is back to do his work. I want to thank him for bringing this matter to its deserved attention. I think his motion is fairly narrow. He is talking about the processes of law and the consultations that should have been done with Parliament. I, of course, support him and agree with him that matters of this nature should follow a very broad and consultative approach so that collectively we are able to ventilate all the issues that affect a decision of this magnitude. I remember that for many years government has received pressure that too much money is given to Air Namibia, perhaps it's a bottomless pit, and all of these things I think were important considerations that had to be made. That finally the decision is taken that a decision of that nature seems very haphazard, very poorly conceived and terribly badly timed, and I think creates in that process a very profound suspicion about the rationale for the decision itself. The second question is, why is it that Cabinet then doesn't follow through to come with such important matters to this House to debate? One wonders if the lack of that process to have been brought here perhaps indicates that Cabinet does not have sufficient grounds to have taken that decision itself. Why do I make the suggestion? First, in taking this decision, Cabinet has redefined what it means to be a parastatal worthy of liquidation. One of the things that are being canvassed in this decision is that about 600 to 700 million is being given to Air Namibia for many years, and sometimes at inconvenient times government has to fork out money to pay for taxes of planes that are being almost confiscated and so on. But when you look at the context of other parastatals and what they get, when you look at the fact that 600 to 700 million is about 11% of what the defense budget is, when you look at ministries and offices and agencies that are getting much more money than Air Namibia, but as in the case of the education ministry, fails to direct and impact society's ability to educate itself and develop itself, you could then argue that the redefinition of what a failed parastatal looks like, and therefore the decision, because it seems to have failed in the eyes of Cabinet, that decision should surely be a decision taken to all other institutions of the state. For instance, if the number of dollars given to Air Namibia is the question that has led to its demise, then there are other ministries that can fairly also speaking be closed. Ministry of Gender Affairs can actually be liquidated.
Yes.
Ministry of Land Reform can also be liquidated.
Yes.
The Ministry of Agriculture can also be liquidated.
Yes.
So that we then also from there move to institutions like NWR.
Yes.
We move to Transnami. We move to RCC and RA and NAM Water and NAM Power and many other institutions. Because which lens of analysis is it that Cabinet uses? And it seems that there is just one lens. We have given so much money, therefore we are fatigued, we must close you down, and therefore save money. That seems to be the fundamental lens. But if that is the only lens, that's a very narrow lens. Because who says name water from the point of view of an Okanyatu person who lives in communal area where they have their water closed down, like they live in an urban area, when they cannot pay, their water is closed down. Who says from the lens of that farmer that name water is a successful parastator? Who says that from the lens of an electricity user that NEM power is a successful enterprise simply because it imports electricity from South Africa, which electricity we pay 25% higher than South Africans? Who says that NEM power, from the point of view of an electricity user in Kwes, Kamanya, in Oshakati, Katima, where electricity is close, who says that enterprise is a success story? So, Honorable Speaker, we can go on and provide explanatory, contradictory views regarding the lens that the Cabinet looked at this matter from. But the lens, surely, that they've looked at Air Namibia from is a narrow one, is one that is devoid of any labor in terms of looking at what are the downstream effects that this enterprise has had positively for the country's economy. So that while an enterprise in its own corporate standing could perhaps not be doing very well, perhaps it may not be balancing its books, perhaps there are problems of management, but its subsequent service creates sustainable economic activities in tourism, in retail sector, and all others. Would you then, if you broaden your lens, come to the logical conclusion that Air Namibia is a failure? And surely, any intellectual exercise would help you to say, indeed, it could not have been a failure, as conceived by the narrow views of Joester and Shimi. I move to the third point, Honorable Speaker, and the motion is very narrow, indeed, as I say. When the law appears to be privatized in the hands of two ministers, who are today suspectus da fuga, they are runaways, just like the head of state has been a runaway head of state for 14 or 9 February.
Yes.
When they decide to privatize such that even their own party has concerns about the manner in which it was done, you have a problem of lack of coordination, and of a lack of view that we send out to society at large, that key decisions can randomly be taken by a select group of ministers and the house is quiet as it is today because people are afraid to speak the truth of what concerns them. Honorable Speaker, at a time, and I think Honorable Dawandenke mentioned it, at a time when this government has not been able to create jobs in the broader economy, does it make sense to take a decision that sends 600, 700 people out of their jobs? Clearly not. What would a responsible legislature have done? What would a responsible cabinet have done? Perhaps a relook at the model which is brought here to engage so that as a team, all of us, could give input and see how this national asset can be revived would have been a far better approach. So that once those opportunities are given on different models, a 49-51%, a 60-40%, all of these models could have been looked at so that at the end of the day, no single political party is blamed, but that as the leadership of society, we are able to arrive at a decision where we can articulate issues to the broader public and say, the collective wisdom of all of us have prevailed. I think that is the gist in which the Honorable Venani is trying to maneuver this issue. When the legislature, in its own constitutional and legal formation, begins to metastasize into a substructure of the executive, you have a problem. Today we are indeed a substructure of the executive. First, because it decides not to come. The Prime Minister, who is the substantive leader of government business, is not here. At least to come here for Minister Joester to come and make a ministerial statement or for the head of state, the Honorable Runaway Dr. Godfrey Keinkop, to even give a recorded version to the nation on television to say, these are the processes that we have followed so far, fellow Namibians. It didn't work. We are trying these ones, but the ones that we have also tried have failed. Therefore, we go for liquidation. It's important that people are taken along in these important decisions, because we are not that stupid as we may seem. And finally, Honorable Speaker, I reconcile myself with the view of the Honorable Kawandenge, who, despite his new glasses, is able to read properly, like as if those are reading lenses, that the decision has to be revisited. Not only because of humanitarian grounds, not only because of the attack on innocent workers of this country, because it clearly is an attack on the workers' class of this country.
Yes. Capitalist attack on the working class.
By those that have accumulated significant wealth, that they now say that you at Air Namibia can now be a victim enough for us that we will send you home and hold on. If you complain, we'll give you some salary for a year, but shut up and go home. That is the attack, but not only because of that, but because every decision taken has a point at which history will revisit the leaders that were taking that decision at that point in time in the country that they were leading. This decision, surely, Honorable Right Honorable Deputy Prime Minister, this decision is one where we can actually, regardless of party political affiliation, come together and say what is best for the country. We can do that. That we can all rise to the level of leadership to the occasion and say, no blame to any political party, what is good for the country, so that 10, 60, 100 years from now, we either are collectively blamed for stupidity that we couldn't come together, or we are celebrated for some semblance of wisdom that we converged when it mattered and took an enlightened decision for the people that it matters to most. Honorable Speaker, I suggest very strongly that the Honorable Deputy Prime Minister and her team swallow the pride, take a step backward, reflect, breathe in,
and engage.
Engage, and you may see a different response than the response that you are getting now. And I think you have the capacity to do it and to do this right. I so hope. Erastus Utoni, thank you, Honorable.
Thank you. Let's move on, Honorable Kavekotora.